In the name of Allah, the compassionate, the most merciful, the blessed Allah. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to biology lesson 7. I think this is lesson 7 of our biology lessons that we have been doing. In our previous lesson, we discussed axial skeleton. We discussed the skull in the previous lesson, the ribcage and sternum, where we said the function of the hips and the sternum is to provoke the production of red blood cells, assist the process of inhalation and exhalation, provide protection to the inner delicate organs like the lungs and the heart. We discussed the hips, types of hips, true hips, false hips, and hanging hips, depending on what is holding them on the front. Like the hanging hips, we said they are two in number. At the back, they are attached to the vertebral column. At the front, they are hanging. And I said these are the hips that will sometimes misbehave because they are not held on the front side. They can sometimes behave and misposition themselves. And then you see someone talking about, maybe I think I'm feeling some abdominal pain, therefore is a hip that has misposition itself. Sometimes they go to traditional healers, they have to do some kind of massaging. When they are massaging, what they are doing is that they are bringing back the hip into this exact position. We also discussed the vertebral column. We started the general structure of vertebral column, the different parts and their function, or the fact that vertebral column may be classified into five depending on the position they occupy. What position they are found in the body are cervical vertebrae, thoracic vertebrae, lumbar vertebrae, sacral or caudal vertebrae. Good. For our lesson today, is about cervical vertebrae. Continuation of what we did, our lesson today will be cervical vertebrae. Cervical vertebrae, I said, are those vertebrae that are found around the neck region. Those that are found around the neck region. And I'm starting my lesson. Hope you can take your notes. Here, what I want you to focus, this is a practical session. When I have started the skeleton, I have started the practical session, and that's why I came with the human skeleton, and I have also some bones that I will show you in the process. In a practical paper 3 exam, when you go to the lab, a bone can be labeled as LK, or and then in an exam room you can be told, name the specimen labeled L. So you should be in a position to identify a bone by just looking at it. Yes, when you see a bone, you must be in a position to say, yes, this is a vertebral bone. That is not enough. You must go ahead and tell us if it is thoracic vertebrae, it is, if it is from the neck and therefore it is cervical vertebrae, if it is a lumbar or what. Yes, you should be in a position. Now I said that vertebral column, the bones of the vertebral column are classified into 5 and they have distinguishable features. For example, the cervical vertebrae, it has got some features that distinguish it from the lumbar vertebrae. It has got some uniqueness in it that make it distinguishable, distinct from the thoracic vertebrae. When we go to the thoracic vertebrae also, they have got their own features that makes them also different. Good. So what you should be focusing should be special features in each bone. When I talk about cervical vertebrae, be keen to see some of the features that are particular, some of the features that are special, some of the features that are peculiar or unique to cervical vertebrae. And I have started. Cervical vertebrae. The number of cervical vertebrae that an organism will have, the number of cervical vertebrae that an organism will have is something that varies from one species of vertebrate to another. Yes, it keeps on changing depending on the species. That's what I'm saying, the number of cervical vertebrae varies from one species of vertebrate to another. But they are excellent for the case of man. If you're interested in the case of human beings, because they are special mammals, human beings have 7 cervical vertebrae in the neck region. The special feature, what distinguishes cervical vertebrae from the rest, is the presence of a canal, a presence of a hole, at the transverse processes. That hole is called the vertebral canal. The vertebral canal, the function is that it is a pathway for blood vessels. It is a pathway for vertebral artery. The arteries that supply blood to this vertebral column and to the spinal cord inside it. Therefore, I'm saying ASTA, meaning this is the distinguishable feature of all cervical vertebrae. All cervical vertebrae have vertebral canals. Where? Vertebral canals in the transverse processes. For what? This vertebral canal is a passage for vertebral artery going in and out of the spinal cord. Good. There are seven in number, but I say the first two cervical vertebrae are distinct from the others. The first two, the one that comes immediately after the skull, the atlas, and the one that follows the atlas called the axis, these two are different. They have some uniqueness. They are different from the other five of the cervical vertebrae. The first two cervical vertebrae, that is the atlas and the axis, are distinct from the rest. They are distinct from the other five. For example, I will start with atlas. What are some of the uniqueness of atlas? It is the first bone of the vertebral column. Yes, that is the general knowledge. It is the first bone of the vertebral column. It has reduced a centrum. What you should remember is that all bones, no matter which position they are found, will conform to this basic plan. They will all conform to this basic plan. Yes, to this basic plan, that all cervical, all vertebra will have a neural spine, they will have transverse process, they will have a centrum, they will also have a neural canal. But depending on the position, these parts can be modified, these parts are specialized so as to make the bone suitable in the position it is within the body. For example, now, for the case of the atlas, the centrum and the neural spine are highly reduced. This neural spine, for the case of when I'm talking about the atlas, the neural spine of atlas is very much reduced, or it is small in size. What about the centrum? The centrum is also small. Come here. What is the function of the centrum? I said the function of the centrum is to provide support. You see, this is the first bone, and therefore, there are no other vertebrae that are found on top of it. There are no other vertebrae that are sitting on it, and therefore, it is for support, and therefore, there is not much weight to support. This is the first bone, and therefore, the centrum is highly reduced. After all, the support required is very small. And then the neural spine is also small. It has a wide, for the case of atlas, it has wide neural canal. These are the features. It has wide neural canal. Why is the neural canal wide at this particular position? You see, allow me to, yes, if this, for example, if this is the good. If this, for example, if this is the head, yes, just like that, then we are saying this is the spinal cord, and I said the spinal cord is the posterior extension. The spinal cord starts right after the skull, so it is bigger, the spinal cord is bigger at this particular point, and it moves downward. As it moves downward, the spinal cord becomes slender, it becomes more thin, and it eventually disappears. Eventually disappears as it moves downward. But what you have to notice is that it is bigger in size during around the neck region. Therefore, to accommodate the big size of the spinal cord, around the neck region, then the neural canal will tend to be very big in size. That's what I'm saying. Has wide neural canal for passage of spinal cord in the neck region. This is a special feature in the atlas. thus has broad and wing-like transverse process. Its transverse processes are broad. They look like a wing, that's why, like wing, lateral projections, they look like a wing-like transverse process. For what? For attachment of neck muscles. Of course, within our neck or around our neck, we have what? Muscles. Has broad facets for articulation with the contour of the skull, allowing for nodding movement. In our previous lesson, when I talked about skull, I said at the back of the skull are two round surfaces that are called condyles. The condyles fit into the atlas, allowing nodding movement or upward and downward movement of the head. That is it now. I'm saying it has got a broad facet. This facet is for what? For articulation with the contours of the skull, allowing for nodding movement. I think I have got a bone here. This is what I'm calling the cervical, the atlas. This is what I'm calling atlas. Atlas, this is the shape of an atlas. Let's check if it has the distinguishing feature or the special feature of a cervical vertebrae, which is the presence of vertebral canals. This is what I'm calling vertebral canal. These are the vertebral canals, this holes here. This is what I'm calling vertebral. These are the vertebral canals, these holes here. For what? These are passage for vertebral artery. These are passage for vertebral artery. Yes. And then what I said is, it has got a wide neural canal. My two fingers can fit into the neural canal. You can see, this neural canal is very big. What? For what? To accommodate the big size of the spinal cord around the neck region. There is it. Also, you can also look at this transverse process. This is it, the transverse, this is what I mean by transverse processes. This part that I'm holding. The transverse processes are wing-like. Where is the neural canal? Highly reduced, you see? No neural canal. I mean the neural spine. The neural spine was a dorsal projection. So we will expect something sharp or a projection, a dorsal projection, but we do not have, and therefore it's just very small in size. You can see the centrum is reduced. Centrum is reduced. No centrum at all. Or it is highly reduced. So that is basically what we mean by atlas. Presence of broad and wing-like transverse processes, presence of a wide neural canal, yes, if you use the centrum, if you use the neural spine. Let me take you to the axis. What about axis? Axis, it is the second bone of the cervical vertebrae. It comes after the atlas. It follows the atlas. The distinguishing feature of this is that it is centrum is modified to form a projection. The centrum of axis is projected, yes? The centrum of axis forms a protrusion or it forms a projection. This projection is called odontoid process. The projection is called odontoid process, has a centrum that is modified to produce a projection called odontoid process. What is the function of this odontoid process? Odontoid process forms a peg that fits into the neural canal of the atlas to allow rotatory movement. Here we have two. Yes? Forming a peg that fits into the neural canal of the atlas to allow rotatory movement of the head or to allow turning movement of the head. Rotatory movement of the head is when you move your head from side to side, yes? Side to side movement of the head, what I'm calling turning of the head or rotatory movement of the head. Where your head rotates is the junction, not that, is the joint between the atlas and the axis. The joint between the atlas and the axis. Therefore, I had it, but I think I misplaced that one. I misplaced it. But it's more of like this, more of like this. But the good thing is that with that one, the centrum is not as small as this. The centrum is big. The centrum forms a projection. It is protruding. Yes? You can even hold it like that. Yes? So when you see a projection, when you see the centrum projecting forward such that you can even have a grip on it, then that's what we are calling axis. So whatever distinguishes axis from the other cervical vertebrae is the centrum that is protruding to form a peak that articulates with the axis. Otherwise, it also has wide neural canal to accommodate the big size of the spinal cord around the neck region. The centrum is also reduced, the neural spine is reduced, you know, like that. It also has vertebrateal, it also has the vertebrateal canal. It also has the vertebrateal canal. What about the other cervical vertebrae? Other cervical vertebrae? Yes? What about the other cervical vertebrae? The rest? When I say the rest, I mean the remaining five. The rest? The remaining five look like this. The remaining five will have something like this. Good. What do I mean by this? It has small neural, yes. If this is the neural spine, small neural spine, this is the neural spine. And then the transverse processes are short and branched. This is a transverse process, short branch. These two is what I'm calling short branched transverse process, TP. Short branched transverse process. The centrum is small centrum, yes, and then the neural canal is big, and then it has what I have here, this one's here. If I put it in a black pen, this one's here. These are called Perizygapophysis. Perizygapophysis. Allow me to say, The other five cervical vertebrae have the other five, just like the others, they have got also the vertebral canal but these ones now, they have short branched and broad transverse processes. For what? For attachment of neck muscles. For attachment of neck muscles. The transverse processes of the other five cervical vertebrae are branched, meaning they are more than two. They are branched, then they are short and broad. Their function is for attachment of neck muscles. These ones, they have wide neural canal. Wide neural canal. Wide neural canal. For passage of spinal cord. For passage of spinal. Passage of spinal cord. They have small centrum. They have small, the centrum is small. Good. This one, they have both peri and post zygapophysis. They have both peri and post zygapophysis for articulation. For articulation with adjacent vertebra. With adjacent vertebrae. Good. The other five subcortical vertebrae, they have short branch transverse processes, they have wide neural canal, they have small central. Yes? The atlas, we said, for the case of atlas, we said the transverse processes are broad and wing-like. It is not branched. Here we are talking about small centrum. For the case of the axis, that is the second bone, I said the axis, the centrum forms a projection or forms a protrusion that we are called the odontoid process which articulates with the atlas. Good. It has wide neural canal. Still, it is a bone that is found within the neck region. And in the neck region, the spinal cord tends to be bigger. And therefore, even these ones, they will tend to have a larger or a wider neural canal to accommodate the big size of the spinal cord around that region. They have both peri and postzygapophysis for articulation with adjacent vertebra. These bones may have facets. And then these facets may be found anterior or the posterior. The anterior one is what I'm calling the front. So the facets that are found on the front side of the cervical vertebrae are called peri-zygapophysis. Those facets that are found on the posterior or that are found on the back side of the cervical vertebrae are called post-zygapophysis. Their name is zygapophysis. Yes, the name is zygapophysis. But we add peri or post depending on where the anterior to bracket peri or whether they are to the posterior to bracket post. Good. Have both peri and post zygapophysis for articulation with adjacent cervical vertebrae. So I will move to thoracic vertebrae.
Yeah.
The thoracic vertebrae is the next thing. Remember what we said on cervical vertebrae. When you see a cervical vertebrae, look for the presence of vertebral canals on the transverse process. If it has vertebral canal, then that tells you whatever you have is a cervical vertebrae. Now to differentiate this as either atlas, axis, or any other, then use the other features that I've talked about. For the case of atlas, I said it has got a wide neural canal, but what you have to consider here is the presence of wing-like projections. For the case of axis, I talked about a projection, the centrum forming a projection, and therefore those are how you can be able to identify. Thoracic vertebrae are found in the chest region articulating with the hips. They are found around the chest region articulating with the hips. If this is the rib cage, then we said on the back side, the rib cage or the hips are attached to the vertebral column. So these ones, is what we are calling the thoracic vertebrae. These are the thoracic vertebrae bones that are found around the neck region. Around the chest region. Good. So, how can we distinguish this from the other? How can we distinguish them? They are found in the chest region, articulating with the ribs. Yes, these are the bones which articulate with the ribs. Now, how can you identify? Yes, in a lab or in an examination room, you might be given a bone. Yes, just like this, a bone. And then it is labeled L. And then you are told in an exam, identify the specimen labeled L. So if you say this is a vertebral bone, that is not enough. Tell us. Tell us. If you say this is a cervical vertebrae, then downward we will ask you justify. Yes, explain why you said it as a cervical vertebrae. Then we start talking about presence of the vertebral canal. If you have identified it as an atlas, then you say presence of long wing-like transverse process, a wide centrum, and so on. If you have identified as an axis, then your justification should be presence of a projection, yes, called the odontoid process that took place with it, something like that. So how can you identify a thoracic vertebrae from the rest? This, I mark it as a star. This is the distinguishing feature. This point will help you. Has a long neural spine. Long neural spine. I will underline this. Long neural spine. This is to overlie surface area for attachment of back muscles. It also has a leg centrum. Transverse, it has transverse processes, but the transverse processes are short. Therefore, it looks like this. Where's my pen? Good. It looks like this. This one. Let me capture it in a different pen. Yes. Diagrammatically, it looks something like this. Yeah, that's the bone. This is the neural spine, long NS, long neural spine. Long neural spine. It has a leg centrum. It has a leg centrum. And then the transverse process, as you can see, when you compare the transverse process with the neural spine, of course the transverse process are shorter. Yes? The transverse processes are shorter. And then I'm saying, there's what I call tubercular facets. They were called tubercular facets. A rib bone will look like this. A rib bone. Yes, a rib bone looks something like this. Yeah. This one is what, if this is a rib, say this is what I call tubercular facet. This is what I call tubercular facet. And then the facet on the lower side, this one, we call it the capitula facet. And therefore, a rib articulates thoracic vertebrae at two points. Rib articulates with the thoracic vertebrae at two points. One, it is at the thoracic, it is up here. Good, let me show you here. A rib bone articulates with a vertebra at two main points. This is my rib. Yes. This is a rib. And then the rib also articulates. The rib articulates with the thoracic vertebrae at two regions. One is a facet that is found on the transverse process. We call it the tubercular facet. And then another facet that is found on the centrum, called the capitular demifacet. Capitular demifacet. Yes. I'm having it like this. And then this is the centrum. This is the centrum. Yeah. If this is a rib, that is a rib. This is sternobrae. That's sternobrae. And therefore, you can see, because I was talking about true ribs, I said the number, then the true ribs at the front, they are attached to the or all the two groups at the front, they are attached to the sternum, at the back, they are attached to the vertebral column. Now we want to see how the ribs, how the all of ribs are attached to the vertebral column. Then we say when these ribs articulate with the vertebral column, they do that at two points. They do that at two points. One of the points where a rib touches or articulates with the thoracic vertebrae is a depression or a facet that is found. Yes, this is now what I'm calling tubercular epiphacet. This is what you are calling the tuberculum facet. You call that tuberculum facet. And then I call here the one that is in the centrum, we call it the one in the centrum, call it capitulum epiphacet. So I'm saying now the tuberculum facets are found on the transverse processes, articulate with the tuberculum of rib. Yes, this one. This is the tuberculum of rib. So this one fits in the capitulum in the transverse process. Then the capitulum of ribs, this one fits into the centrum. So basically, this is what I mean by the point, the tuberculum facets on transverse processes articulate with the tuberculum of ribs, while capitulum in the facets of the centrum articulate with the capitulum of ribs. Boys, what I mean, class, let me check you through this. This is my bone. This is it. Yeah, this is my bone, the anterior view of it. Thoracic vertebrae. You see, you cannot confuse this with any other bone. Look how the neural spine is long. Yes, it is long. It is lengthy. When compared to the short transverse, these are the transverse processes. These two are the transverse processes. But the transverse are too short compared to the neural spine. Yes, this is the neural canal. This is the centrum. This is the centrum. Yeah. And then the facets I've been talking about, something like that. So basically, that's about the thoracic vertebrae. They are distinguished from the rest by the fact that they have long neural spine, and this is it. This long neural spine is what will enable you to easily identify this bone in a practical session, or when you come across this bone anywhere. This is thoracic vertebrae. Why? The justification should be presence of long neural spine. Stop Aristotle. Good. What about the lumbar vertebrae? What about lumbar vertebrae? Yes. Lumbar vertebrae, of course, are bones that are found around the abdominal region. We said these are bones that are found around the abdominal region. This is it now. They are found between the thoracic and the pelvic region. This is the pelvic region starts here, and the thoracic ends here. So this bone that we have inside here, this one, yes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, of course. For the case of man, they are 5 in number. So that's what I'm saying, are found on the abdominal region. They are found, their position is around the abdominal region. Yes? And are 5 in number. For the case of a man, they are 5 in number. For the case of any other vertebrate, any other species, it also varies and depends. Good. So what are some of the special features? What are some of the special features, observable features of lumbar vertebrae that will enable you to differentiate it, to distinguish it from thoracic, from cervical, and any other bone? Yeah, Zia, it's my pen. Good. Same. Have long and broad transverse processes. I will draw it here. Okay, with a pen. I will draw it here. It looks like this. Looks like this. That is it. The transverse processes are long. Yes. The centrum is wide or big centrum. Yes. We can have here. Big centrum. The centrum of lumbar vertebrae is very big. And then what about the neural canal? The neural canal is small. Yes. Small neural canal. What about the transverse process? Long TP, long transverse processes. Why? You see, I said every vertebra will conform to the basic plan that we have discussed in the previous lesson. All of them, they have contained the neural spine, the transverse processes, the neural canal, the centrum. But those parts are modified to enable bodies to fit into where they are. They have long and broad transverse processes, and then start meaning. In fact, when you just look it at like this, you will see a long transverse process, and that is the one that will enable you to distinguish. Even could not look for any other characteristics or any other feature, you will see the transverse. Yes, for the case of thoracic, I said it has got long neural spine. For this one, what is long is not the neural spine, but the transverse processes. Long transverse have long and broad transverse process. For what? For attachment of abdominal muscles. Have big and thick centrum for support. The centrum, as you can see, is big because the bones or the lumbar vertebrae are bearing, they are carrying the weight of the thoracic vertebrae. Yes? The thoracic vertebrae, they are tall of number, I did not mention them. Thoracic vertebrae, if I did not mention them, they are tall of number. So the lumbar vertebrae are supporting the weight of the thoracic vertebrae. In addition to that, they are also supporting the weight of the cervical vertebrae. So generally, to support and provide the rigid structure required, or the support required by other bones, then the centrum, the basin, that is now, the centrum will tend to be very big, be broad and thick, because it is seated on by the total of thoracic vertebrae, by the seven cervical vertebrae. Would have big and thick centrum for support. Have small neural canal. Yes, the neural canal is small. Why? Because I said the neural, I mean the spinal cord, as it moves downward, as the spinal cord descends downward, then I say it becomes slender, it becomes thinner, and around the pelvic girdle it even disappears. So here, the spinal cord is slender in size, and therefore the neural canal also tends to be narrower in size. This is narrow, that's the right word. Half small neural canal, narrow neural canal, that's the half broad neural spine. The neural spine may tend to be also broad. And then I'm talking about the half peri and post zygapophysis for articulation in the vertebrate with other or adjacent cervical vertebrae. Yes, so we can have good. Okay, this is what I'm calling perizygapophysis. Perizygapophysis. This one is because there is a bone before this. These are facets in which now this bone uses to articulate with the bone in front of it. Then it also have postzygapophysis. Postzygapophysis are facets that are found on the backside that enable this particular bone to articulate with the bone behind it. So generally, like that, have peri and postzygapophysis for articulation with other vertebrae. So generally, this is how bones can be differentiated. How the bones of the cervical vertebrae, can be differentiated from the rest, and then also lumbar vertebrae, those are the characteristics, thoracic vertebrae, these are the features. So kindly revise, look these distinguishing features. For the case of cervical vertebrae, you can also be able to identify them. Lumbar vertebrae, in fact, what is examinable is this three, the cervical, lumbar, and so on. Because in the next lesson, inshallah, I'll discuss about the sacral and the sacral and the caudal vertebrae, and then move to appendicular skeleton. Those ones, they are fused. Those ones of the sacral are fused, and therefore you cannot differentiate which one is in which one. They are just form one solid bone. So generally, find this in our next lesson. We'll do sacral vertebrae, caudal vertebrae, and appendicular skeleton. See you in the next lesson. Thank you.